I love Audible. I'm a huge reader, but I always want to read while I'm doing things you're not supposed to be reading while you're doing them, like driving, like walking. It can be dangerous, you know? So yeah. I really love to use Audible.
Yeah, Audible is great. I have been really interested in this book Tomorrow and Tomorrow and Tomorrow by Gabrielle Zevin. That's probably going to be my next Audible experience.
Audible lets you enjoy all your audio entertainment in one app. You'll always find the best of what you love and something new to discover.
Try Audible free for 30 days. Visit audible.com/crappins or text crappins to 500-500. That's audible.com/crappins or text crappins to 500-500.
At Bombas, we make socks, underwear, and T-shirts that feel good and do good. They feel good because they're designed with the softest materials and comfort innovations. They do good because for every item you purchase, we donate another item to someone who needs it. So far, we at Bombas have donated over 100 million items, and your purchases add to that impact. Go to bombas.com/Wondery and use code Wondery for 20% off your first purchase. That's bombas.com/Wondery and use code Wondery at checkout.
Watch what crappens, watch what crappens. Who cares what happens when there's so much that crappens?
Crappens, crappens.
Crappens, watch what crappens.
Hello and welcome to Watch What Crappens, a podcast about all that crap on Bravo that we just love to talk about. I'm Van Mandelker, and joining me today is the beautiful and just all-around lovely person, Ronnie Karam. Hi, Ronnie. How are you today?
Oh, so good. How are you doing, sweet guy? It's so good to be back here. Watch what crappens.
I'm actually not doing well because I feel like last week I shared about how I had COVID, and I'm like, I'm sharing, but what are you sharing, Ronnie? I feel like you're not sharing anything with me right now.
Oh, my God. Well, I do have spots. I'm bald.
But you're not sharing.
And I'm very...
But you're not but sharing.
Traumatized.
But that's not...
You guys bathing
But we don't know anything about you, Ronnie.
I'm like literally so traumatized. Okay, welcome to Real Housewives of Trauma and Selfies. That's what this show is. All they talk about on this show is how they're traumatized by some shit. And by the way, I'm not accusing this of being fake trauma or fake shit to be sad about. They've all got real stuff to be traumatized by. But for fuck's sake, man, every episode is trauma, and then they cry, and then they go take selfies for literally an hour. What the hell?
Yes, we're talking about Real Housewives of New York. And by the way, I did have COVID last week. I tested negative this morning. Whoop, whoop. So thank everyone was so sweet. A lot of nice little messages or comments on social media. So thanks, everyone. I'm mostly out of it. You may hear a cough here or there, but it was a pretty rough week for my throat. It was a very sore throat experience last week. But I'm back.
Lord knows you beat that thing up enough. Not only this, but in your private life.
Woo-hoo!
And you needed a break. And also, you know what? Your COVID, your trauma, you went through your trauma. Guess what? You talked about it openly with us, your friends.
Open and honest.
And then you didn't take a selfie like a douchebag. Instead, you took pictures of a gorgeous chocolate cheesecake that you made.
No, there actually was
a
selfie,
friend
too.
I can get behind.
There also was a selfie. There was a selfie.
Listen, you mix it with a cheesecake, and that makes it very important.
Okay. I did. You know what? Because I decided on Saturday night, I was like, I'm fucking sick of this quarantine. I'm stuck in this quarantine. I want to do something fun for myself. So I made myself a chocolate cheesecake. I'm home alone these days. God, Dom is in New York getting ready for his musical. So I'm just here doing nothing. So I just made a chocolate cheesecake for myself. And it was great. And
that looks good.
It was really good. And I'm gonna post the recipe on my newsletter this week because everyone should know about how to make this chocolate cheesecake. So everyone get subscribed, MBD Fancy on Substack.
Yeah, you guys, come to our extras stuff. Ben does MBD Fancy, posts on his Instagram. I do these Cooking with Nancy videos and shopping videos. I
TikTok.
Posted a shopping video from the Hobby Lobby today, which you want to talk about a politically correct place to go shopping with your mother. Crafts and Jesus, honey. So that's over there on my TikTok and my Instagram. Go over there. We just never stop.
Yeah,
okay? We're constantly trying. You guys, we're all about food and content. Okay, like Sai.
We're about, you know what? This seems like a great time to make some content. Okay, let's do some staircase content.
Guys, let's do some content.
So we are actively creating content. This is meta content right now. Before we start this recap, next week we have Crappy Hour is back. So come join us. That's going to be at 5:30 p.m. Pacific or 8:30 p.m. on the East Coast in America. If you're outside of the country or in a different time zone, please consult your local timetables. And that's going to be on IG Live. So follow us at Watch What Crappens. And we're going to talk about all sorts of Bravo gossip or the latest shows, all the fun stuff, you know, like We'll Talk, You'll Talk, all that good stuff. And lastly, we're on video. In case you didn't hear, we're on video. Go to patreon.com/watchforcrappens. Support on the Crappens on Demand level, and you get access to this beautiful video. I forgot to put up a background of Anguilla today. I failed at this video. And that's basically it. So let's talk about Real Housewives of New York, Ronnie. We're in Anguilla. It's night one. And the women have just... they're now like walking down a stair. My first note is women coming downstairs, ooh, ah, et cetera. You look amazing.
Yes, there's a lot of, oh my God, you look so good. Oh my God, you're wearing clothes. Oh my God, you're wearing different clothes. Remember when I saw you last time, you were wearing different clothes than you're wearing right now? Because right now your clothes are really, really good. Okay. Also, can I just say to this music? This depressing ass music person, okay? They're still with us. The fucking Alanis Morissette of Housewives Trixie Monica.
Wait, now okay? That sounds Trixie, like that's that makes me happy. I feel like we need to give a different musician because if you say it's
Trixie Morissette.
Trixie okay, Morissette.
Okay, so who's like an extremely depressing female songwriter, singer songwriter?
Sarah McLachlan, who I also love, or Tori Amos,
yeah.
Or.
Trixie Amos Cole. Does that make sense?
Tori Monocle.
I think we've always got to keep the Trixie, right?
Trixie. A depressing.
It's
Barbie.
There's different names for Trixie.
Billie Eilish is kind of depressing. She's always like.
Eilish Cole? Okay, so this is Trixie Eilish Cole. Or since it's Bravo, Eilish Cole. Which you could call her Eilish Cole. She is so depressing. I swear to God, would you fucking lighten up? Okay, and I get that part of this is my generation. I'm young, first of all, young end of Gen X, okay? I'm on the very babyish end of Gen X. So I get that I'm like an old man on his front lawn shaking his fist at heaven now. I get that I'm like that, okay? I admit it. But a lot of this is me just saying, like, this generation literally needs to stop crying every 5 minutes. I can't take it. Like, even the songs in the Housewives music, is this sad? Okay, this is the song. I've been out on the ocean, searching for something that ain't blue. What the fuck are you doing on the ocean then, looking for something that's not blue? Of course fucking Trixie Eilicle goes to the fucking ocean and then complains that everything's too blue. I mean, you want to talk about somebody from a younger generation. That's it. I'm shaking my fist on her lawn. I've had it.
Trixie Eilicle really needs to come up with better content. Okay? It's official.
She stopped crying. She was like, searching for something that ain't blue. Wait a minute. I'm going to do some content here. Actually, I really love that wave. Anybody?
This is a good wave. Look at that turtle. That's a nice shell. She sells seashells.
So here's my note. Night one, woos as people come downstairs.
Yep. Aaron, are you wearing underwear? And then Sai says, no, should I? I don't have time for underwear. So, by the way, I also had a revelation about Aaron. And by the way, I actually really, believe it or not, I'm really not coming today from a space of like, fuck this show or anything, because I actually did enjoy this episode. And I'm not trying to be full of venom or whatever, but I realized who Erin reminds me of on the season. She reminds me of Andrea from season one of Melbourne. Sort of like this bland villain energy, you know, where
Andrea was amazing, wasn't she?
Andrea, but she was amazing as a villain. That's true. And then, but she's sort of a blandly villainous.
Wasn't she the one who's like, you know what I love? The spirit of nature.
No, that was New Zealand. She was amazing. No, Andrea was the one who's like, can I give you a little advice? I just want to give you a little advice. And Gina hated her. And she just was like blandly villainous. And so I kind of feel like that's Erin's energy a little bit.
So that's Real Housewives of Melbourne you're talking about?
Yeah, Melbourne.
Let me see Andrea.
Andrea, season one.
I love that show. It's one of my all-time favorite housewives.
I know. They need to really.
And I'm wondering why I don't remember her.
Because she was only one season.
Andrea Moss. Oh, yes. Yes. Oh, can I give you a little advice?
a little friendly advice? You shouldn't act like it.
By the way, her business is called Liberty Bell Skin Cena.
What is that?
Liberty Bell? Isn't that the oldest cracked ass bell? Like, that's the most cracked bell I've ever seen. I know.
And what is she talking about, Liberty Bells in Melbourne? It has no...
Who wants to look like the fucking Liberty Bell, Andrea?
Literally the worst bell you could have chosen.
You might as literally well. The worst. Can we get like Motel 6 like reception bell? I mean, at least that one's smooth if a little rusty.
It's like saying Venus de Milo orthopedic surgery. It's like, but she has no arms.
Come to Venus de Milo, where we give you a high five. Like, wait a minute.
Mona Lisa threading. It's like, but she doesn't have...
Mona Lisa teeth work. Well, I guess that would make sense. Hey, do something that Mona Lisa never got to do. Open your mouth when you smile.
Michelangelo David's penis enlargement center.
Boxing Helena rollerblades.
Moving into more of current art. From the 90s.
I don't know how I just jumped to 80s Sherilyn Fenn references, but hey, listen, it's Monday, okay?
Pablo Picasso, normal human body shape services.
Okay. So
anyway, they've come down the staircase.
Erin is dressed in Ashley Madison print, like she's wearing. What are you wearing? This is, come on, you're on the beach, loosen up, lighten up a little bit, enjoy yourself. By the way, I'm also not coming from a fuck this show kind of place.
I'm not
from an old person, I feel. And also, I don't care, I'm not explaining myself if I am coming from that place.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm not apologizing for it, I'm just saying I'm not. But last week people were like, oh my god, Ronnie's so mad. You know why? That's how I get joy. I had so much fun last week with the episode.
Plus, also, I was reading recap. It because I was coming from a place of COVID and I was like, you know what? Fuck everything right now. So I was definitely like fanning flames of rage. I felt like
Loved it. I felt so good. I mean, I really left Monday like, oh my god, that was amazing. We're winning the Nobel Peace Prize.
I generally thought the first like 25 minutes of this episode or 30 minutes of this episode were actually really good. And then it was just like hanging out on the beach. But so the women, anyway, they're coming down the stairs still. So Uba's walking.
Literally as long as we've been talking so far. That's how long it took them to compliment each other coming downstairs.
Because basically, okay. Bravo, like the Real Housewives fall into two camps. There are the walking down the staircase going, woo, at shows like Beverly Hills, this show. Yeah. Dubai a little bit, Atlanta. Then you have the shows that are just like pure camp ridiculousness, like Salt Lake City, New Jersey, Miami. And so this show is just a woohoo coming down the stairs show. And I just have to...
It's a woo show.
It's a woo show. Real, it's like, don't you want to be like these women? Aren't you excited to be like these women? Aren't these like fabulous women kind of shows? So
speaking of, Uba comes down and she's like, oh guys, I'm bringing my mug from the house. I'm so wacky. I'm bringing a mug from the house. This is a mug that belongs in the house. I don't even care. I'm bringing it.
And then someone goes, oh, that's very... I think it's maybe Sai. She's like, they say it. That's very like Rihanna because she always walks out of restaurants with a glass. I'm like, that's also Ben Mandelker in Las Vegas. I mean, like, or Pam on vacation in Vegas with her 6 foot long beer bong thing walking down the street that she got at Jimmy Hoffa's, but Jimmy, what's his face? He just died. Margaritaville. Jimmy Buffett's Margaritaville walking down to the MGM. So
I love that Rihanna does that. And Uba does too. And she's like, oh yeah, I'm just like Rihanna. You know what? Even Rihanna has a ha in her name because she's hilarious and wacky like me.
Erin somewhere saying, what's Fenty? I've never even heard of Fenty. Is it like a fence? Is it tea? I don't get it. Like, it's confusing to me.
When I heard it, when I first heard Fenty, I thought it was like Fendi spelled wrong. It's true. I have to admit it. Because while I'm admitting to being an old person, that is definitely one of the things that I got schooled about a long time ago. Sorry.
Wow. Okay. It's all coming
Where's
out
Where's a Rihanna golf polo? Where's that? Where's, see, there's nothing I can buy. Is there a Kirkland brand Costco ass golf shirt from Fenty? There is not. So get off my ass.
I'm really glad you came out of the Fenty closet there. That was a moment of vulnerability, and thank you for sharing. Because I feel like this is the real Ronnie now. I feel like you've like really shared. So,
I mean, Old Navy was fun for a long time, guys. But now I am old, and I feel attacked every time I go there because they're like, "Old,
like, old I just want to go to Navy.
Where's Young Navy? You know, just Navy.
Young Navy.
Youngish Navy." Yeah. Holding on to youth, Navy.
Speaking of holding on to youth, so now the women all climb into the vans to go off to dinner, and Jess is like, "Ooh, I smell a pot. Does anyone smell pot?" And it was like, "Oh, it might be a raccoon or something. I think it's a raccoon." And then they're like, "Oh, she means skunk." So then Jessel like taps the driver on the shoulder or something. Goes, "Excuse me, person, poor person, do you have skunks on this island?" He's like, "No. Just terrible tourists, specifically in this van."
Yeah. So they go over what they're going to do tomorrow. Aaron's like, "What's the plan tomorrow?" And so I was like, "We're going to do beach. We're going to have breakfast. Then we're going to go to lunch. Then we're going to go to dinner. Then we're going to have a snack. Then we're going to go by the McDonald's. We need to check out the McDonald's here. Like, is it the same as where we're from? We're going to McDonald's in Anguilla. I mean, this is such a side vacation. You know what I like to eat? Okay, my idea of vacationing is food, relax, food, snack, relax, food. Hilarious."
Okay, I'm just gonna just woosah, as they say, as Gigi Golnessa. So she loves food, guys. That's her thing. She just loves food. So they arrive at this. So they show up at this beach shack. It's really cute beach shack, like a Caribbean beach shack. It's nighttime. There's like picnic tables and everything. It's like fun. It's beachy and everything. And they're so, like, half of them are so overdressed. Like, Jenna's dressed perfectly for it. She's got a nice long kind of flowy dress and a little jean jacket. Like, some of them are dressed like chill. But like, Jessel is in this like big red couture thing. And Sai is in like a couture thing. Or maybe not couture, but like definitely like not beach shack vibes. I'm like...
This is Housewives. I don't want to see people in shorts and jeans and shit. Bring me your crazy clothes.
I mean, it's on the one hand, it's hilarious, right? Because they spend all this time getting dressed. They do a walk down the staircase fashion show, and they're just going to a beach shack.
Yeah.
You know?
They don't go to one place here that's not a picnic table with picnic benches. And this place is special, though, because it's called the Sunshine Shack, which I feel like you can only work at this place if you're a bitter asshole. Yeah. I mean... I feel like really nice people can't work at some place called the Sunshine Shack. You know, they need something a little less on the nose. But Leon, the server, seems very nice. He's like, "We have a special drink for you tonight. The Sunshine Shack Special. SSS. I was like, that's... Okay, so now you're homophobic, too. Because that was hard to even repeat. The Sunshine Shack Special. Sunshine Shack Special. Sunshine Shack Special. SSS. No. It's like your drink is my disappointment.
SSS also stands for Social Security System in the Philippines. So it has a very bureaucratic undertone. So I looked up SSS because I was like, I'm pretty sure that stands for something.
Sunshine Shack Special.
Sunshine Shack. Sunshine Shack Special. Well, listen, when you're at the beach, you know what? You know what? You know what's the real home of tongue twisters is the beach. I mean, she sells seashells at the seashore. So it's
she
like
she sells seashells at the seashore.
Sunshine Shack. It's a Sunshine Shack. This really is made for Sheena.
Welcome to this. Can I have one each of the Sunshine Shack special?
Hi, I'll have one.
On the seashore.
Hi, well, I'm Sheena. I'm now working at the Sunshine Shack. The Sunshine Shack.
I'm Sheena Shay.
Hi, it's Sheena Sunshine Shack.
Hi. What is Sheena Shay? It's Sunshine Shack.
It's just like a video.
Would you
that
like
plays.
A Sunshine Shack special from Sheena Shay?
Hi, I'm Sheena Shay, and I'm at the Sunshine Shack. Welcome to Sheena Shay Sunshine Shack. If you would like one of our margaritas, please ask your server, Leon. Thanks.
So Uba and Jenna order with no alcohol, and Aaron's like, "Yeah, and then you could do the other four really sexy and really strong.
Non-virgin." So, Uba.
How dare you accuse me of being a non-virgin on the night I'm renewing my vows? Like, what are you calling me a slut in my own vow renewal?
She just, Erin just turns to Leon and goes, cackling hags? So the land, so Uba, she's like,
Sunshine
I did not.
Shock special.
What? So everything else is not special? So, Uba says that the lamps and the decor remind her of home, and she tells a story about how her mom didn't have any money for oil growing up, and so they would just go to bed early at night. And then all the women go, aw, that's sweet. I'm like, I don't think the point of that story was to be like, isn't that so sweet that they went to bed early because they had no money? I think it's like, oh, that's
rough. No oil for the lamps.
They're like, aw, yeah, like, oh my God, cute.
Great story. Uba's hilarious. Isn't Uba so funny?
Isn't it funny how her mom was like so destitute they literally didn't have the money to keep the lights on at night? That's so sweet.
And Bryn's like, that is so sweet. You know, I've never been to Africa before. And Uba says, yeah, well, don't think about what they show you on TV. Because on TV, they just show you a kid with this big stomach. That's not Africa. Africa is the shit. And I was like, okay, first of all, can we leave the little kid with the bloated stomach alone? Do you think that kid is not going through enough shit in life without having Sally Struthers fly in on Southwest, come out, come off that plane with a fly swatter, and just start crying all over your damn head when you're hungry? Those children are starving. Can we not?
Commercials. Here comes one right now.
Hey, listeners, you need to know that Wondery's shocking true crime podcast Over My Dead Body is back for a fourth season, Gone Hunting. This newest season covers the story of Mike Williams. It was Mike's sixth wedding anniversary when he set off on a hunting trip into the gator-infested swamps of North Florida. He figured he'd be back in time to take his wife Denise out to celebrate, but he never came back. Friends and loved ones feared he met his fate through bad luck and a group of hungry alligators, leaving his young family behind. Except that's not what happened at all. And after 17 years, a kidnapping, and the uncovering of a secret love triangle, the truth would finally be revealed. Enjoy Over My Dead Body, Gone Hunting on the Wondery app or wherever you get your podcasts. You can binge all episodes of Over My Dead Body early and ad-free on Wondery Plus. Get started with your free trial at wondery.com/plus. I want you to picture Steve Jobs tinkering with a computer in his garage. Walt Disney drawing cartoons for his high school newspaper. Every big moment starts with a big dream, but what happens when that dream turns out to be an even bigger failure? Each week on Wondery's new podcast, The Big Flop, host Misha Brown is joined by different comedians to chronicle some of the biggest failures and blunders in pop culture history. Each episode will have you thinking, why in the world did this get made? From box office flops like Cats the Movie to Action Park, New Jersey's infamous theme park that had countless injuries, many lawsuits, and rides so wild it became known as Class Action Park, or Quibi, that short-form video platform with an even shorter lifespan. It's a story of a spectacular failure with lots of surprises along the way. Enjoy The Big Flop on the Wondery app or wherever you get your podcasts. You can listen to The Big Flop early and ad-free on Wondery Plus. Get started with your free trial at wondery.com/plus.
By the way, can I just take a moment to talk about, you know, recently this episode's all about sharing and not sharing. And to be fair, we have complained that Bryn has not shared. Well, actually, Bryn has shared a lot on the show. But
Bryn shared a lot.
Bryn has shared a lot, but we have complained that we don't know what Bryn does. And Bryn got into a dust up with.
I don't think we've called her a hoe, though, have we?
I don't think we speculated that
she's like a high class hooker or anything.
Maybe
like
at one point we made that joke, but to be fair, we make that, I think, about every housewife at some point in their tenure. So that's like, welcome to the club.
And literally every gay
but,
as well.
An Instagram account, is it Bravo and Botox? Go follow them,
Bravo
everyone.
And Botox.
Yeah, they they made a joke, I guess, about like, what does Bryn
even
do?
They were doing a Twitter roundup. So they were taking tweets from around the internet and they were posting them as a roundup, you know, in their stories. And a couple of them were like, wait a minute, you know, what does this chick even do? And one minute she's talking about a Saudi prince. And then the next minute she's in like a car with like a Bentley with like an old Hugh Grant type. It's giving sugar baby, or it's giving seeking arrangements or something like that. So then Bryn wrote into them, and she went off on them, basically. She DM'd them, went off, and was like, how dare you call a woman a whore? And I'm not a, you know, went off on them, which, you know, listen, if we have the right to say stuff as commentators, then I feel like people have the right to say things back. I will say, not cool to insinuate someone's a hoe. On the other hand, you're a housewife now. Like, it's going to get way worse.
Yeah,
it's, you guys have to just not listen to anything about you and stop reading about yourselves. This is the rough and tumble world of Real Housewives, guys.
Yeah.
Okay, you're going to get your feelings hurt literally every day. Stop it.
But
listen to this.
Yes.
Don't read the Instagram.
But what's interesting, though, is that Bryn also posted that she had sent her bio into Bravo. She claims she's sent her bio into Bravo like several times, showing like all the things that she has done. And that Bravo has not put up on their website. So sort of saying that Bravo has done her dirty. Although that doesn't explain her Spartan LinkedIn. So there's
that. She posted, because we've been referencing this LinkedIn and I couldn't find it to actually read it. But Bryn, she posted it herself in defense of herself. She said, the other girl's bios are so, that's 5 O's in case anyone's counting, heavy on both their professional past and future ambitions. I'm proud of my career history, so sort of feel like I'm doing myself a disservice by omitting my career entirely and or diluting it to one professional title. Okay, and then she posts her about me thing that I was referencing from her LinkedIn. Bryn Whitfield has a wealth of experience working on award-winning campaigns for global brands. Huge dash. Managing and executing strategic media relations programs for clients including Shell Oil, Unilever, Johnson & Johnson, and 1.7 billion e-commerce scale-up and tech unicorn Assembly. Whitfield's career highlights include working on the BP Deepwater Horizon Gulf oil spill.
Great.
Wow. You're hired. I mean, why did you open with that? Why do I have to get the paragraph too?
Well, look, is anyone talking about that oil spill anymore? I don't think so. Looks like she did a good job.
But I love that she went from the working on the BP Deepwater Horizon Gulf oil spill.
I caused that. I was flirting.
The oil was unspilled before I got there.
I was flirting with that pipeline, and I guess it burst.
Playing a pivotal role on the PR team responsible for the massively award-winning. Okay, come on. Who wrote this for you? Did AI write this? Playing a pivotal role on the PR team responsible for the massively award-winning Dove trademark beauty sketches campaign, which was the recipient of the Cannes Gold Lion Award for Best Integrated Campaign led by PR. Okay, that's quite
the
first sentence,
ever. The first ever commercial that featured an oil spill getting a Dove makeover. We asked five oil spills.
From the oil spill and into soap. I would have loved to see one of those poor seagulls that was covered in oil. Just like, you know what? I'm proud of my oil slick. I'm just going to put a little conditioner in it and go on with my day.
Hi, everyone. This is Bryn Whitfield. I'm representing the oil spill. Look, it's just like, it's actually kind of sexy if you think about it. It's like the ocean is like now kind of like slick and shiny and like it feels really good. So like I think all the fish are really happy and like, I don't know, like I was engaged to it for a moment, but I just had to run away.
By the time I was finished, all of those oil slick covered fish had blonde wigs on. And they were all together. Do you remember that campaign?
You know, my friend was in that campaign, and I want to tell everyone this. Well, I don't know why I got very impassioned all of a sudden. My friend was walking.
Sure did. I love it.
It's because my friend was walking on the street, and someone walked up to my friend, Jacqueline, and was like, "You would be perfect for our Dove campaign." And she actually, they gave her a card. She looked into it. And she wound up being in one of those commercials. So, like, those really are real women. Like, my friend Jacqueline was in that campaign.
Oh, my
Isn't
God.
Crazy?
I love that.
I'm always sharing that with excitedly to be just not to say, like, oh, my friend was in it. It's more to say, like, it really was real women. I can confirm it was real women.
For people well, that's, for 10 that's years. A pretty cool thing. I would have that on my LinkedIn.
Now, why don't we have Real Housewives of Dove commercials? How about that?
Okay, so she goes on to say she also did Zycam stuff and blah, blah, blah. And then the third paragraph is, a Midwest native, Brynn graduated from Purdue University with a Bachelor of Arts degree in rhetorical advocacy. The fuck is that?
It's rhetorical questions. What the fuck is that? I know how to ask a rhetorical question.
That's a literal question, though, because I don't know what it is. Rhetorical advocacy. All right, let's just play devil's advocate. So I like to think that they call Brynn and they're like, Brynn, we heard you're amazing at rhetorical advocacy. Can we just have you like devil's advocate this? Okay, so we've got a bunch of fish covered in oil slick. Well, okay, just playing the devil's advocate. Was it the fish's fault for, like, swimming around an oil pipeline? Like, wow. Duh. Am I right? Like, who's responsible for making signs so that fish know not to go near oil pipelines? Like, literally stupid. Am I right? Okay, that was just rhetorical advocacy. Don't get mad at me.
So rhetorical advocacy. So according to rhetorical advocacy is... There's a lot of things. It seems like it's actually a controversial topic because there's the first thing that came up was like a right wing thing that was like, fuck rhetorical advocacy. So it's.
Well, of course. They're like, rhetorical advocacy, turn my children gay. They're grooming my baby.
Like the first thing that came up was like, rhetorical advocacy is licensed to lie. So I don't know. Oh, Purdue University. I think it's something about it's public relations, in depth study of a particular area of public relations and rhetorical advocacy. I don't know. It's something with lobbying, and I think it's like lobbying, basically. It's like you are speaking and you are advocating for something, and so therefore, oh, you're lobbying for like white jeans because I turn into Carl when I discuss rhetorical advocacy. Okay.
She's also got a minor in political science. In her spare time, she enjoys being a young patron of the New York Met and a member of the Marshall Chess Club, which, I mean, you know, hopefully she's gotten better, and has volunteered with nonprofit organizations, including the Bowery Mission, School on Wheels, One-on-One, and Border Angels. And so over this, on her story, she wrote, also, I flagged my career being omitted time and time again, and it's out of my control if you don't get to see me working and only see one side of me. Take it up with someone else, but you're sure as hell not going to say gross stuff about me, sweetie. Well, and then gives like one of those side kisses. So there you go. There's her whole...
For someone who majored in rhetorical advocacy and did PR campaigns, I think this is like maybe not a great example of your skill set. Like maybe next time just go on to your own IG and be like, hey, everyone, this is what I do. People have been wondering what I'm up to. This is what I do. So I agree. Like we talk shit. Instagram people talk shit. So you know what? What goes around comes around. All is fair. But that being said, Brynn, just post it on your Instagram and like set the record straight. Like you have the power. Be a rhetorical advocate for yourself and shut us all up.
She eventually did. Did she? That's what she did. Never mind. You know? Yeah. Well, she posted all this stuff that she did and says what she does. And
well, Bravo did her dirty then.
That's what she's saying. Yeah, she said that she works all day, but that no one wants to sit around watching her take all these Zoom calls or work on 50 page decks. And that she didn't say this, but I read that she can't show her apartment because they won't let her film there. It's like a co-op or something. So I don't know. I don't know why I'm spending this much time on Brynn. Like, who cares? I just thought it was interesting because it was a big fight that broke out in the Bravo universe.
Yeah.
This
but
week.
It also answers questions that we've had. And it sounds like Bravo did do her dirty, which sucks. Sucks for her, for sure. And by the way, I think kind of speaks to, again, some of the dysfunction on this reboot, which is that there's just like... I feel like there's certain things. I don't know. I just feel like some of the emphasis.
We're not getting into dysfunction of the reboot because right now we are having Sunshine Check specials. So
oh my God, you're right. Never mind. No, this is not a dysfunctional reboot.
Let's keep the sunshine in this shack.
Sunshine Shack. Sunshine Shack specials. Africa, guys. Africa is great. So Uba is saying she just loves it. And she's like, you know what? Africa, she's like, this place may be heaven, but Africa is paradise. And it just doesn't have very good PR. We need Jessel. We need Jessel to do PR for Africa. I'm just imagining Jessel saying, welcome to Africa. This is a beautiful continent, especially because Pavit isn't anywhere near it. I told him there was a banh mi sale in Hanoi, and he's all the way across the world. So come to Africa. It's beautiful here.
come to Africa, where one thing you won't have to worry about listening to is drivel spewing out of a man's mouth about the importance of fried chicken.
No such thing as the fried chicken club in Africa. That's for losers in New York City, specifically at the address 123 Pavitt Lane.
So Jenna gives a review for the sand. She's like, oh my God, the sand is like so soft here. It's like really soft sand.
5 stars.
So now they start talking about shoes because it's this show. So I was like, oh my God, Jenna, are you wearing flats right now? Those are like so cute. Those are like flat shoes. They're like shoes, but like they're flat.
Thanks for your approval. Like, oh. Thanks for telling the person who's like famous in fashion for, thanks for your approval of her, what she's wearing.
Are those edible? Because I'm like starving right now. Like I could totally eat your flats.
Yeah.
I'd love to eat.
So then Jessel says to Jenna, Jenna, my best friend Jenna Lyons, can I borrow that dress? Because I absolutely love all the sartorial things that you have and anything that you give to me, I would absolutely praise for the rest of my life. Can I borrow that dress? We'll do a dress swap. Hey, Bryn, not a wife swap.
And Bryn's like, don't even. Bryn Whitfield graduated from Purdue University, and she was also has a wealth of experience working on award-winning campaigns for global brands, managing and executing strategic media relations programs for clients including Shell Oil, Unilever, Johnson & Okay. I was just suggesting wife swap because it was like swap. That's all. Jeez.
By the way, I have to say,
whatever BP, that was a real BP oil spill. Just playing devil's advocate.
I have to say, my favorite version of Bryn is pissed off Bryn, because I feel like that's when she drops like this cute, like flirty thing, and then she just suddenly like her whole demeanor changes.
Like, fuck you,
fuck you. That's not cool. I'm like, yes, that is my that I fuck with that Bryn. So
she turns into Kathy Moriarty. She's like, oh my God, you really?
How dare you say I would wife swap?
So we get to a flashback again at the anniversary party where she's flirting with Abe, and then Sai is like,
that was a good one, Jessel. That was like really, really funny, Jessel.
And Bryn's like, can we be done with this conversation already?
And so now Uba enters the conversation. She's like, speaking of the wife swap thing, Sai, would you be mad if she made that comment about David, about the wife swap? And Sai's like, eh, I don't give two fucks. You know what? If she left a comment and also a pork rib, okay, it would go over better than just a comment without a pork rib. But you know what? It's not because I hate comments. It's because I love pork ribs. Can we get some food over here? Jesus Christ, I'm about to eat the soft out of this sand.
If she made that comment about David, I really wouldn't give a fuck. But if she asked me to hold up a sandwich from Subway with the branding on it and didn't pay me, yeah, I would be really pissed.
So Bryn's like, Uba, stop that. And so I was like, don't ask me. You know what? I'm a terrible person to ask. And Uba goes, but it's just hypothetic. Jessel, what about you? And Bryn's like, I really don't like stuff like that. I really don't. And Jess goes, yes, she really doesn't, Uba. And Uba's saying, well, they're defending Bryn and saying they don't care, but they're liars. I'm not taking Aaron's side. I'm taking a married woman's side because I know how I would feel. It would not fly. Oh, God. Please don't. Uba, the one thing I feel like Uba has going for her on this, I mean, other than being stunningly gorgeous and extremely charismatic and everything else that she's got going for her in life, I think one thing she's got going on this cast is she's one of the ones who hasn't seemed to take every little thing so seriously.
Yeah.
So I don't like her jumping on this like, oh, now I'm offended for married women everywhere. The woman was fucking joking.
But I did like her kind of just like weighing in with like an opinion, like in the sense of like not just being wacky. She was like, that was fucked up, even if I didn't agree with it. So Aaron is like, she's like, I so appreciate Uba right now, one of my fellow real New Yorkers. She's such a loyal friend. She fully has my back and she's speaking up when no one else did. I'm like, you were speaking up when no one else did. You were not... ma'am, you are not a civil rights project here. Like, you are not like the ACLU. We're not, we do, you're acting like we need to call in the ACLU over the stupid joke, okay? Like, no.
You're some rich, privileged lady with a free second wedding.
Yeah, that's there was like a joke that you were not privy to, and you've made at this point that joke happened mid-December. At this point, they're somewhere in January. This has been like a month, maybe even up to 6 weeks that you've been holding on to.
It's a whole new year now, girl. Drop it. So Brynn's like, seriously, though, I do want to seriously, seriously, genuinely apologize for graduating from Purdue University. And also for saying that your party was boring. It was rhetorical.
It was just boring compared to an oil spill, okay? Like when oil spills and it's flowing out of a pipeline for like months on end and fish are just dying, that's exciting. Speeches at an anniversary party are just less exciting in comparison. So you can see how I would naturally say that.
And then she's like, your party was not boring. And Sai's like, yeah, it wasn't. And Aaron goes, thank you, because that was very mean. So I think now that we're getting to know Aaron better, really all Aaron wants, I think she nitpicks every little thing about situations because she's addicted to apologies.
She
I think
is.
And there are different love languages. You know, mine is food, frankly. Food, maybe food. Laughter. If I can make someone laugh, that's my love language. That's all I want to hear from people, really.
Yeah.
Okay, just laugh. Hers is apologies. She will nitpick everything, but she'll let it go kind of if you just say you're sorry. That's all the woman wants.
Or cry.
She just wants a sorry.
She also loves to nitpick until someone cries. Or she's one of those people that feels like you're not being real until you cry, which is very Beverly Hills, right? So Brynn is basically like, I said your party was boring because I just wanted to hurt you because I knew that you're so shallow that if I said your party was boring, that would actually shatter your world instead of you just saying, okay, fine, and move on. So Aaron is like, well, and she goes, I was hurt. Brynn says, I was hurt because you accused me of something really disgusting that wasn't true. And Aaron goes, I wasn't accusing you of anything, which is a lie. And she goes, Brynn says, you accused me of flirting with your husband, and I've never cheated, and I've never flirted with someone's husband. All I do is go to parties and scroll through pictures of my nude self near other men, which is a totally different concept. And I've never done that, let alone to a friend. You know me, even though I feel like we all just met right as we started filming. You know me. I would never do that.
Well, this is so silly, too. So they're both being silly here. I think, obviously, she was flirting, but in a joking way. Yeah. That's her shtick. Like, she's always flirting. She's gorgeous. She's hilarious. She's a flirt. Yeah. She makes flirty jokes at the wrong time. So to say I wasn't flirting is silly. It's a joke. All you have to say is I was just joking, okay? I would never seriously try to steal your husband.
Yeah.
And Aaron has to stop joking like she really cares because nobody really cares. Like literally anybody who's seen Brynn for 5 minutes knows that she's kidding. But also Brynn can't get so offended like, how dare you accuse me of cheating when you make your whole shtick is about cheating. Or like, how dare you suggest I'm a sugar baby? Your last scene was like with a guy trying to buy a $250,000 car that looked like a very sad Hugh Grant. And you brag about dating Saudi princes. Like, you're leaving breadcrumbs to take people to certain places, and then you get mad when they follow the breadcrumb. Don't kick the rats for following the cheese. You know what I mean? Stop putting out cheese. Close the refrigerator door. And stop being so offended. Like, who cares if you were flirting? Just tell her to get the fuck over it. You didn't do anything wrong.
Brynn did nothing wrong. But that being said, this sort of... this martyrdom is kind of great. I mean, that's what I've been asking for all season. So Aaron is like,
oh, I love martyrdom.
You know, like
whole religion's built off of,
you know,
it.
Like me flirting when I've described that's like my personality. But Aaron also is like, you're friends with Brynn and you know that's her personality, so you can't be mad when Brynn's just doing Brynn.
Commercials. Here comes one right now.
And Aaron's like, oh my God, guys, what are you talking about? Like, I'm just surprised that you're apologizing about the party being boring and you're not apologizing about it. She goes, no, I was apologizing that it was a mean thing to say because I didn't mean to hurt you in that moment. I did. And she goes, but it's like, you're not apologizing for like flirting with
my
husband.
I'm so confused. Like, I'm sorry. I'm like, what's confusing, actually Aaron? Confused.
She was joking with your bitch narc of a husband, okay? Because your bitch narc of a husband tried to tattletale on her to get her shanked in the lunch line, and now your humorless ass can't accept that you're not owed an apology. You're not owed one. Sorry, denied.
Yeah.
Move along.
And then Brynn's like, what are you confused about? because I can rhetorically advocate for myself if need be. And Aaron's like, well, I thought you were going to apologize about divorce, talking divorce and wife swaps and making jokes. Like, that was worse. And Brynn's like, okay, that was an inappropriate and bad timing to make those jokes, so I'm sorry for that. And then Aaron goes, thank you. So you think those are appropriate jokes to make? Let's just apologize.
Oh my God, I can't. Like, I can't. When she said thank you, I was like, okay, love language acknowledged. Okay,
she wants to beat people into submission. Yes,
she does.
But then she still wants more.
You think those are appropriate jokes? And she's like, oh my God, there were jokes and you weren't even there. Abe was laughing. And Jess was like, yeah, you went there. She was laughing. Abe was laughing. I was laughing, mostly because Parvett had food on his mouth and nobody told him. I mean, everybody was laughing, mostly at Parvett. I forgot what we were talking about.
It was all done in a way that I honestly didn't think that you'd be upset about it, you know? And Upa's like, well, I think it's all bullshit. If someone said that about your husband, you'd be really mad. And Jess is like, well, it depends who it is, because honestly, like, if someone wants to take Parvett off my hands, I'm really not going to stop them.
If someone came up to me and said they wanted to fuck Parvett, I'd say, can I borrow whatever contact lenses are in your eyeballs, please?
And I'd say, here's a bib so that we don't get chicken grease on your chest.
And Aaron's like, well, I don't think it was appropriate, and I'm allowed to have that feeling. So, like, why do we have to keep talking about it? Because you won't shut the fuck up. You won't shut up. Why won't you just stop? Please stop. I'm, like, in the fetal position. Just
I know. And Brynn's like, and I'm apologizing. And Aaron's like, and I said thank you. No, you said thank you and then kept asking questions about it. So Brynn goes,
yeah, thank you, but you think that's appropriate to say.
And then Brynn, in a real good sign for her housewife's career, goes, so I don't get any apology for being accused of something that awful.
Oh my God.
But actually, at first I was like, this is so ridiculous.
They're two sides of the same coin, these two. They really are. They get pissed and offended over things that aren't real to make drama. And it just makes for the lamest drama. They need to, their personalities, I think, would fit better with better drama. But they're just going on and on about.
But I was actually into this stupid thing. It was so stupid, but I was into it. And because at first I was like, oh my God, Brynn is so ridiculous. Now she wants an apology. But I can also imagine that, like, if I falsely accused you, Ronnie, of something, like, Ronnie, like, stop flirting with Dom, and you're like, I was making a joke, I'd be like, oh, I'm sorry. Like, my natural instinct would be to apologize to you for making an accusation. So I can actually see where Brynn's coming from in a certain way, but I also think, like, yeah, the love language on this cast is all about apologies. Who can apologize sooner and faster and bigger?
Yes, and just keep going with it and groveling, because it gets to the point where an apology is not good enough. Like, you have to just keep apologizing. So now Brynn is playing her same game by saying, I need an apology. And then Sai's like, oh my God, can we just order now? Really? My God, I'm starved. I just ate one of Jenna's shoes. Okay, let's order. I'll have the snapper. Okay?
Yeah, Leon
You're
has
already
come back.
Sitting next to her. You're literally already sitting next to her. It's like the quickest delivery of something I've ever seen on one of these shows.
So this was the most offensive part. And I noticed that people on Facebook were really, really pissed about this point too, because I know I was, and I was glad to see other people were. So Leon's there to take orders, and Aaron goes, why are we calling him over? We're having a conversation. Lady, this food needs to be ordered, okay? This is island time, okay? Put that food in right now. I can't, but like, you can press pause on this stupid ass apology duel.
She can't.
Well, she doesn't want to eat food. That's the thing.
She will not only not feed people on vacation, she also refuses to let people order on vacation. That's her thing.
Yeah. She, like, does not want food near her, unless it's going to be her shakshuka. So, Sai's like, I have to eat.
Even then, her ass didn't get out of bed to make the fucking shakshuka.
It's true. The shakshuka. So, Aaron is, like, really pissed that they're ordering food while she's trying to have a scene. And Sai's like, how do we kill this? Okay, how do we kill this? And Brynn now is, like, annoyed at Sai. And Brynn's like, you know what? Can you just allow us to talk? We don't need you to referee Sai. And Sai's like, but I'm over it. I'm over it. Well, congratulations. Welcome to the rest of the audience watching your scene, Sai.
Yeah. Aaron's like, I just can't get a word in. Oh my God, you're saying the same words over and over. You're very offended, Aaron. We all get it. You're extremely offended. Can we just all apologize to Aaron? Well, okay, let's just go. Can we just please, can the next group trip be to India? Everyone can literally wear a sari all fucking day for Aaron, okay?
Also, Aaron, when the words you do get in are like, I'm just like confused. I'm like, this is confusing. Like, every time she gets into a fight, her whole vibe is like, you're crazy. So, like, yeah, maybe the words you, if you can't get a word in, maybe it's because the words you've already put in have not been that interesting. So Aaron's like, Grins goes, just talk. So Aaron goes, I'm trying. I mean, the reason I was being normal with you today is because I know you didn't mean it in a malicious way. I know that. That being said, all I'm saying is that I thought it was an inappropriate place to make those jokes and it hurt my feelings. And can we just like squash it and move on? And I hate like now Aaron does this thing like, hey,
what's the big deal?
What's the big deal? I just said it was inappropriate and now you're making it a whole thing. I'm like, you're the one who walked into the wreath party with a sour face and told us you deliberately wanted to ruin the wreath party the way your party was retroactively ruined, even though it was not actively ruined in the moment by the stupid joke that Bryn made.
Well, you know the old saying, don't bring a knife to a gunfight. Is that what it is?
Yeah.
Don't bring a gun to a knife fight. Well, whatever it is.
Don't bring a knife really to any fight.
I think it's don't bring a,
yep, don't bring don't a knife, bring to, a knife
to a gunfight. Yeah. Something. So that's what's happening here. Basically, Bryn has been going about this all the wrong way. And now she whipped out an equal sized weapon, which is you owe me an apology. And now that she said, you owe me an apology, Aaron doesn't know what to do. It's like completely flummoxed her. And so now Aaron's like, well, why are you making this such a big deal? Which is hilarious. And I just have to say, yes. Very well played, Bryn. You know, yeah. Very good.
Yeah, you need to, because that's what Aaron needs. Like a moment, like when, if someone, you have to like be bigger than Aaron. And that way she'd be like, oh, you're crazy. It's not a big deal. I was just saying this. That's it. Bryn was smart by giving Aaron the floor to have like a little monologue, which was a stupid monologue. So now Aaron feels like she's the shit and all is good. So they hug over the table and then Bryn goes, sorry, I was trying to do a Larry David bit and it was bad timing.
So they hug and sad music plays because that's the show. They only play sad shit. So Aaron goes, oh, by the way, Abe loves you. Fuck Abe and his tattletaling little rat ass, okay? Abe does not love her. He just tried to like ruin her whole fucking season by running and making it sound like she was like the whore of Babylon coming onto him at your wedding. I don't want to hear it from Abe. Okay,
so dishonest,
Bryn's like, oh my
Abe.
God, I trademarked Abe the Babe, by the way. Know what I'm saying? I trademarked it rhetorically. Like, don't get upset.
Just so you know, I did name the oil spill Abe. It's different Abe, though, but if I'm talking about Abe, it's the oil spill.
Oil the BP. Abe
the
BP.
Yeah.
Can't make that work. So Aaron tells us, dumbest apology ever. And Bryn tells us,
well, I didn't want to hurt Aaron at her kind of boring party.
And then Bryn tells us,
you know, I know I didn't flirt with Abe because that's like messing with someone's family. That's like something I would never do. I care way too much about her and our friendship. And I care way too much about Abe.
I can't stop it. Oh my God, I just can't stop flirting, which I would never do.
So then Sai's like, all right, is there anything else we need to clear the air here? Like, what else do we need to talk about? And Uba's like, oh, someone needs to say I'm beautiful, wacky. And Aaron's like, Jenna, your turn. So why don't you guys just be done with it, Jenna? Because like, why don't you be done with the shit I just started when I turned everybody against you for no fucking reason?
So Bryn is like, I mean, who doesn't prefer business class over coach? And Jenna goes, guys, it's not like why I didn't come with you and you know it. Like, did you actually believe I didn't come with you because I said I didn't want to fly coach? Like, seriously, do you believe that? Seriously, do you believe it? And so I think I do.
I do too. Don't you? I do too, and more power to you. The fuck, you gonna apologize? No, don't apologize, okay? You don't apologize to people in coach.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think that she wanted to fly business, which is fine. I think it was presented by Aaron last week in a way like she was being totally snotty and saying, I don't fly coach. When she said, no, I want to go earlier so I can tan. And also, I really want to fly business. There's a, by the way, there is a difference between saying I want to fly business versus saying I don't fly coach. Even though it seems like it's the same thing. She was being jokey.
She made it into a joke, like, I'm going to get sun, but also really, because she sees Aaron just looking at her. So I think she's like, but also don't want to fly coach. Like trying to be more relatable in a way.
But like also saying I don't want to fly coach or saying I want to fly business implies like, this is what I'd like to do for myself. When you say I don't fly coach, you're saying this is my status in life. And she didn't do the latter. And there's a big difference. But Aaron presented it as if she said, you know, my status in life is that I am a celebrity and I therefore don't have to fly with you, you know, you proletariats in coach. And that's not how it was.
Yeah. So I wrote, who cares? So that's where I'm at. So Jen's like, and by the way, that's not to you. That's literally in my notes. So Jenna's like, well, yeah, that wasn't the case, guys. And so I guess, but it's a big part of it. And Jenna tells us, I think, the perfect point, which is, I don't think that anything you say, like, post-op on anesthesia should be held against you. Like, that's not fair. Like, that's literally not fair. Which I agree. Yeah. You can't.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's not HIPAA necessarily, but it's like you can't come to somebody when they're vulnerable with a sweetened thick soup and then use everything against them. Yeah.
I like that Jenna goes, the only thing I remember from my post-op phase was that there was soup involved. Other than that, I have no idea. And the soup was supposedly butternut squash, but tasted just like pureed shakshuka, which was weird. But although I did fly business, I get a pass because who cares? Yeah. That's exactly right. I get a pass because who cares?
And Aaron's like, oh, I mean, it was coming from a good place because, like, we just wanted to be with you. And Jenna's like, I mean, come on. You guys don't give a shit if I was on a plane or not. That's not true. See, maybe that's the problem. Yeah, but, like, it never occurred to me that you guys would care that I was on a different plane than you. I'm adding a period between each word, hoping that you guys will get this, but it doesn't seem Morse code. Are you understanding this if I do it like it's Morse code?
Oh, hold on. I just got a text from Emily Hampshire, and she says, yes, I do understand it. I guess my celebrity friends hear it. So then Sai goes, but you exclude yourself as if like, wait, what? From what? She's here. She literally showed up a day early. Okay. So I'm sorry she was not there to sit in the row with you and to watch The Art of Driving Fast in the Rain or whatever that fucking movie is. Okay. I'm sorry she wasn't there to weigh in on whether or not you should get the Biscoff or you should get the pretzels. Okay. That's not excluding yourself. That is just having a slightly different schedule.
And so now Bryn brings up her big argument, which is, you give us gifts instead of, like, connecting. And Jenna flinches. She's like, like, I cannot believe I'm about to get yelled at for giving gifts.
Yes.
So then we see a clip of her giving a million presents to people. And Bryn's like, by the way, I love gifts, so keep them coming. But it can't be like you give me a dope shit, but then you don't share anything. Like, you tell random strangers what your real name is because of your brother, and I have to hear it from Sai, and I have shared so much with you. And it's like, I mean, what about everything I shared on Thanksgiving? And, like, you didn't share anything. And, like, I don't know anything about your personal life.
Should we roll back the footage of Bryn saying, so Jenna, I really want to, like, know more about you. Like, tell me about you. Oh, that's right, because that footage doesn't exist. Okay. Like, the way to find out about, I understand. I actually, believe it or not, I understand some of the point, which is that, like, giving gifts is not a substitute for having, like, connection with people. Like, that's, I think, a fair point. But the point is, if you listen to Jenna, she has actually shared things. Because we've learned things outside of just her interviews. But, like, I don't think
she's
they really listen.
More than anybody else. Like, what do we know about Erin except that she's rich? She grew up from rich parents and she's in real estate and she got remarried to Abe. Like, we don't know any.
Her parents had a house in the Hamptons. His house had a parents in the Hamptons. And they realized we should get married and we can all live in the Hamptons.
Yes. Like, what do we know about Sai? We know everything about Sai, but look what we know about Jenna. We know all of her fucking insecurities. We know her mother's problem. Like, her mother's
Asperger's.
We know about how they had to grow up in the house, how she had to deal with her mother.
She
how
told
her
this
mother
to Aaron.
Died.
Yeah.
The pain of her mother. Like, what do you mean she has
we also know
anything?
She also told them about how she was outed by, like, Page Six or something, like 10 or 11, 12 years ago. And that was really traumatic for her. Like, The thing is that you can know someone without having to know the depths of their trauma also. I do believe that. Like, it's, you know, when you learn, when people share their trauma or their difficult past, that of course enriches a friendship, I guess, in some ways. Like, you learn more about them, but you can still like learn about someone just by like learning their habits, or there's more to learn about someone than there's just their trauma. And like, you know, and I feel like these women are like, unless you've only shared your trauma, we don't know you.
Well, it's a form of currency, you know, it is kind of a currency. You see it reflected in all the shows we watch and the people we know, you know what I mean? And just conversations you have now, people take such pride in their trauma almost. And I'm not saying that, and you know, for someone like me, it's been important for me to learn how to share stuff like that and to like grow. Like, I wasn't raised like that at all, but I can actually open up about stuff now that you just couldn't do when I was growing up. It was not a thing. Like, you would get beat up. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So in one way, I'm thankful kind of for the modern thing of just like being able to share how you fucking feel, because that's huge. That's hugely new. And I don't think people understand how modern of an idea that is and how repressed this world was until pretty recently. So for a lot of it, it's okay. But it's also turned into this form of currency where right. you're not worth anything unless you are miserable and you have misery that you can literally share on the drop of a hat. You can't go on a reality show. You can't go on a competition show unless you are ready with... You can't even fuck people on The Bachelor unless you're ready to talk about every single thing that's traumatized you and cry on cue about it. And if people say, we need more, you have to do another 10 minutes more about trauma. And it's becoming this, like, inauthentic bullshit drivel. It's just more tap dancing that people are doing actually to get fucked or to get ahead. Right. It's like the only way you could do it is to have this trauma to fall back on. And it's getting kind of gross.
Well, I think also there's probably an element, you know, when, like, if you've shared like deep trauma, because by the way, like, Brynn and Sai have shared deeply traumatic stories, and Sai shares another one later this episode that's really moving, you know. And I feel like probably there's an expectation of like, okay, now I've shared mine, now you share yours. And I don't think everyone operates that way necessarily. And so I understand why they kind of feel like this isn't fair because I just bared my soul. But I think there has to be an understanding that people bear their souls in different times and in different ways, and that there's like value in learning about someone's, you know, my therapist always says, like, life is full of big T's and little T's, like big traumas and little traumas. And there's value in little traumas too, you know?
Yeah,
and
like, start with the little traumas.
Like, not like you don't want to always, you know, you don't always want to bring out your big T's all the time, you know? Dude, like, there's like little trauma, okay? Like, yes. Jenna's given lots of little trauma, so.
You need like little trauma bricks to build a friendship, okay? And then once you can climb that wall, then you get to the big T but wall.
In this case, you know? So I understand why Brynn feels like it's not fair, because she has bared her soul, what she, and like these really tragic stories of her past and the stories of like rising above, etc., which is great. But then when she says, you tell random strangers what your real name is and I have to find out about it through Sai, I'm like, that's like, you're kind of making it all about you right now. Like, you want to know about her, but you're like really concerned about your relationship to what her backstory is. And I just feel like it's not a strong point on Brynn's part.
Well, two things. I think she's just making stuff up to be mad about because she's on Real Housewives, because none of this makes any sense. I don't think Jenna's done anything to deserve the treatment from these witches that she's getting on this. Another, I think Brynn's kind of projecting because she has talked about how rich she dates. Like, she tends to date really wealthy guys. And I think maybe she feels like there is a lot of gift giving because that's how they're showing her love, assuming that she wants all these expensive things, where maybe she wants a deeper connection and is wondering why she's not finding it. Ooh, I think maybe there's a little bit of that. And then there's also the fact that Jenna that and Sai ran right to everybody else and tattletaled, and so you're putting her in a position where why would she want to open up to you?
And especially like when she's already shared
one little thing, and you guys are using it against her as a group, which is like super shitty of all of you to be doing.
And especially because Jenna had shared BTW that again, the Page Six thing, which was that she was outed, and like she was actually really felt burned and hurt by that entire experience. So she's probably very guarded about who she shares information with. And the fact that no one realizes this, like, It's like she actually shared something about herself that no one has thought to themselves like, oh, this might explain a lot. Let me create like a safe space for her to share rather than like accusing her of all this shit. Like, oh my God, you exclude yourself. Why don't you share? Like, I had to find out through Psy because you told a girl the Jenna genitalia. And by the way, how is the Jenna genitalia be like, you hear that story like, wow, I feel like I really understand Jenna more. No, it's like, you know, an anecdote.
It's stupid.
You know, an anecdote for crying out loud. Hey, so we're going to pause this recap right now. We're going to wrap this one up. This is the end of part one. You good with that, Ronnie? Because we're about to...
Yes. Okay, listen, good. If we're going to go 2 hours, we've got to wrap it up.
We're going to wrap it up. And we will see you all on part two. Bye, everyone.
Bye.
Watch What Crappens would like to thank its premium sponsors.
Know Your Worth with Jason Kurth.
Ain't No Thing Like Allison King.
Ashley Savoni, she don't take no baloney.
She's not just a Sheila, she's a Daniela.
Itchels.
Erin McNicholas, she don't miss no trickolas.
She's never scary, it's the Green Fairy.
Hava Nagila Weber.
Jamie, she has no last namey.
Sipped some scotch with Jessica Trotch.
Kristen the Piston Anderson.
She's always supplying, it's Kelly Ryan.
Megan Berg, you can't have a burger without the Berg.
You're never alone with Lacey Monteleone.
Let's give a kisserino to Lisa Lino.
There ain't no problem that Sarah Salvia can't solve ya.
Ruru LaRue.
The Bay Area Betches. Betches.
And our super premium sponsors, the incredible edible Matthews sisters.
Somebody get us 10 cc's of Betsy MD.
She's not harsh, she's Jill Hirsch.
We're taking the gold with Brenda Silva.
Erica 500 Days of Summers.
She's the queen bee, it's Sarah Lemke.
We love him madly, it's Kyle Pod Chadley.
Don't get salty with Christine Pepper.
Let's go on a bender with Lauren Fender.
My favorite Murdo, Karen McMurdo.
Nobody holds a candle to Jamie Kendall.
Give him hell, Miss Noel.
Can't have a meal without the Emily Sides.
Let's get real with Caitlin O'Neill.
We want to hang with Liz Lang.
Shannon, out of a cannon, Anthony.
Let's take off with Tamla Plain.
She ain't no shrinking Violet Kuchar. We love you guys.
Hey, Prime members, you can listen to Watch What Crappens ad-free on Amazon Music. Download the Amazon Music app today. Or you can listen ad-free with Wondery Plus in Apple Podcasts. Before you go, tell us about yourself by completing a short survey